This is what we traditionally have as our kickoff event for our new member here. It's great to see so many familiar faces as well as a lot of new faces. I'm really, really thrilled on how many new faces are present this year. And I really do want to thank Donna and the Child Development Association for hosting us again for the third time in a row. It's a lovely facility. And I think we all appreciate the fact that we're in air conditioning. So, this year is a year celebration for Roswell Women's Club. 65 years ago, in the spring of 1948, a group of about 30 women came together and eventually joined to form Roswell Women's Club. This year, the theme I've chosen is, Who's Your Sister? And forgive me because many of you have already heard this. Over the last 65 years, Roswell Women's Club has experienced a great deal of sisterhood. So who is your sister? Take a moment and look around. No, really, look around at your table. And you'll see the sisters that make up the most successful. You're looking around, thank you. You're going to see the women that make up the most successful women's service club in Roswell. We've given over $1.8 million to the community in the form of scholarships and grants. And I think we should applaud ourselves for that. Our sisters, along with others, help shape the community we enjoy. Did you know our earlier sisters founded the first kindergarten class in Roswell, as well as the first Girl Scout troop? We helped start many organizations that now serve Roswell. Did you know that our sisters helped to start the Roswell Historical Society? And it was an offshoot of our own historical committee that still functions. We were also instrumental in forming the Fine Arts Alliance, Roswell Parks and Rec, Roswell Garden Club, Child Development Association, Chattahoochee Nature Center, just to name a few. We did this with other leaders of the community, of course, but many of our women have been the impetus behind those organizations. Roswell Women's Club members were behind the campaign to encourage the city of Roswell to purchase Bullock Hall and eventually Smith Plantation and Barrington Hall. Many of our members continued to be involved by doing volunteer work at these various organizations and serving on boards and are active contributors. I encourage us once again to emphasize our hands-on commitment to volunteerism in our community. And that's going to be one of the emphases this year. Roswell Women's Club at the club also has wonderful sisters. We have the various organizations like Childhood Development Association in this community that are sisters. And we're lucky to have these sister organizations that provide services and education to Roswell and North Fulton community. I'm sure a lot of you probably looked at Roswell for the quality of our schools in North Fulton. So we welcome the opportunity to support our sister organizations through grants, scholarships, and volunteerism. So, who is your sister? This year, let's all plan to get to know more about our sisters and to achieve the words of our vision statement. We strive to cultivate friendships, foster personal growth, and enrich the lives of others. I am humbled to be elected your president and look forward to the excitement of this coming year. Thank you. And I'm going to ask Betty Lee. And Betty, if she would come forward to lead us in our collect and the Pledge of Allegiance. Hopefully, there is somebody at each table who has a copy of it for the new members. Betty?
Keep us, O God, from pettiness. Let us be large in thought, in word, in deed. Let us be done with all finding and leave off self-seeking. May we put away pretense and meet each other face to face without self-pity and without prejudice. May we never be hasty in judgment and always be generous. Let us take time for all things. Make us grow calm, serene, gentle. Teach us to put into action our better impulses, straightforward and unafraid. Grant that we may realize it is the little things that create differences, that in the big things of life we are as one. And may we strive to touch and to know the great human heart of us all. And, O Lord God, let us not forget to be kind.
And if you'll remain standing, we'll do the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd like to thank our hosts, the Women's Development Association, and I would welcome Donna, the Executive Director of CDA, to come join me.
I bet you can hear me without the microphone. It's always a pleasure. No?
That's a first. It's always a pleasure to have the Roswell Women's Club in this building, whether you come as individuals, whether you come to serve on our board or to be part of a derby committee. It's always wonderful. But to have you all here together for your kickoff luncheon, we are so excited that this is becoming a tradition. I get the feeling that you love to be here and we love to have you. You have meant so much to the development and the growth and the success of the Child Development Association. And today to have the First Lady, Sandra Deal, who is this incredible statewide champion for early literacy and for children, that's just sort of, you're the icing on the cake, Mrs. Deal. Our mission is to prepare economically disadvantaged youngsters for success in school. And the Roswell Women's Club has been an integral part of our success in achieving that mission. You are an exemplary organization that stands behind us in our work, and we are grateful for that every day. Your timing for this luncheon is perfect. You have caught us in the middle of our NACE reaccreditation process. That's the National Association for the Education of Young Children. It is the highest form of accreditation that a preschool can have. And needless to say, we are really busy around here. We're scrambling to put everything, make everything perfect, and anxiety is running pretty high. We're very lucky to have a new center director, Marla Reisman, and she's providing a very stable hand and great leadership in that process. But it's perfect timing because you helped us so much to achieve reaccreditation in 2008, particularly with your support for our teachers' education. You helped us then, and you've helped us every year since to stay abreast of the NACE standards, which are always rising. When I came 8 years ago and first met the Roswell Women's Club, you helped us get teachers who had not graduated from high school across the first finish line, the goal line of achieving their CDA certificate. It was required for NACE. Now, NACI requires associate's degrees and bachelor's degrees, and thanks to you, we have stayed on top of that. We have a much more qualified staff than you could have even imagined those few years ago. And I'm really excited to tell you that yesterday, Marla came to me and asked what kind of support could the CDA provide for teachers who want to pursue their master's degrees. I'm gonna get choked up. You have taken us so far. You have lifted us up. You have helped us professionalize our staff. You have raised morale. You have given women a window to an ambition relating to children and relating to be the best, most qualified teacher that they can be. So you've lifted up the women, but you have also lifted up our children, because there is simply nothing more important in a preschool than the quality of the teacher who stands in front of that room, who is interacting with those children on a daily basis. The better the teacher, the better the whole classroom experience. There's nothing more important that you could ever have done for us than to support our teachers. So thank you, thank you, and thank you. Most of you know a lot about us. You've been deeply and intimately involved with us. Our core mission is to operate a children's center. It serves children ages 1 to 5. We provide this fantastic nationally accredited preschool program. In calendar year 2012, we served 260 children in 9 classrooms. 3 of those are Georgia pre-Ks, which we're very, very proud of. In 2012, I think it was the same year that Mrs. Deal came to read to our children, an independent evaluation of Georgia's pre-K program was commissioned by the state, and our classrooms were found to exceed the national and state averages on 9 out of 10 criteria. You can be really proud that your fingerprints are on this. Along the way, we've picked up some new programs in these last few years. One of them is connected to the Georgia Pre-K. For the last 2 summers, we have been invited by the state to offer something called Summer Transition Program, which is an additional 6 to 8 weeks of kindergarten-type programming for the children who are rising from pre-K to K, to make sure that when they get to the kindergarten door, they are as ready as they can possibly be to thrive in that new environment. And this past summer, we also got a rising summer transition program to assist the children who would be coming into our pre-K program. So that was helping the 3-year-olds making the transition, the 4-year-olds making the transition into pre-K. And that program was especially targeted at non-native English speakers. It was specifically targeted at children who speak Spanish at home. And we have a very diverse population here, and it's a population that we really seek to serve. So we've added those summer programs for our kids. Also, some of you may or may not have heard, 2 years ago we launched a new program called Kids Express. This is a drop-in early learning program. It's in the North Fulton Service Center in Sandy Springs, and we also have one in the Adamsville Regional Health Center. This is a classroom with qualified teachers and an enriched environment, where children can come while their parents avail themselves of the services in the building. So they come to the Grady Clinic, or they come to the tax assessor's office, and they don't have to tote the 2-year-old with them. That child gets to come and play and learn with us. And our goal in Kids Express, which now serves 3,000 children, this year will serve 3,000 children. Our goal is actually to introduce the parents to the idea of early childhood education, to let them know that that young child, regardless of their youth, is ready to learn and ready to play with educational toys and to make puzzles and do all those wonderful things. For many of these parents, it may be the first time they've ever met a qualified teacher. Their child's not old enough for real school, so we're hoping that we have little light bulbs going off about what their children are ready for. And the other program that we're very, very proud of, and this is under the leadership of our new education director, Roxanne Leopold, and came to us through the generosity of the Governor's Office for Family and Children, which is represented today by Katie Jo Ballard. We have a new program, it's a System of Care grant, it's what we got from the Governor's Office, and the idea is to wrap these young children and their families with a system of care for the Child Development Association to work with that family in concert with many other social and human services in our community. And the number one thing it did for us is it enabled us to launch Parents as Teachers. We now have 3.5 parent educators who go into private homes to help the parents of 65 children in their homes. We are coaching and mentoring and educating those moms and dads and caregivers on how to prepare their children for school.
Wow.
So there's a lot going on here. There always is, and we always need you to keep us moving forward. I want you to put 3 things on your calendar. I'll be real quick. On October 23rd, you are all invited to our Howdy Partners Celebration Luncheon. October 23rd, right here, same space. We're gonna put on cowboy hats and bandanas, and we're gonna have the kids sing, and we're gonna give some awards to community organizations that, that mean a lot to us. On October 30th, at the Country Club of the South, we will be celebrating our 45th birthday. And we would really love to have you there with us to help us blow out the candles. And last but not least, on Friday, December 13th, we are launching a new fundraising event, and don't groan. This is going to be a blast. It's called Santa Night. And what we're gonna do is we're gonna pile lucky folks on, Santa wannabes, I call them, not so good singers is what some other folks on my staff call them. But anyway, we're gonna load you onto trolley cars and you're gonna go restaurant to restaurant all over Roswell and Alpharetta and sing Christmas carols. Dressed as Santa, it's gonna be a blast. So, you know, like us on Facebook, be looking for emails and communications from us. It's gonna be a lot of fun. But once again, just thank you from the bottom of my heart for being here.
I am going to just take a brief deviation from our agenda because we have
3-year-olds?
Yes. New 3-year-olds, so just kind of 2+. Waiting to entertain us just briefly, and rather than keeping them in the hallway.
Right. Miss Kenya's 3-year-old class is on their way. These are 3-year-olds who, you know, school just started in August, so we'll enjoy this.
Together, the happier we'll be. The more we stay together. Together, together, the more we play together, the happier we'll be. Cause your friends are my friends, and my friends are your friends. The more we play together, the happier we'll be. Let's go! 2, 4, 6!
Holds education dear to her heart. Mrs. Deal has been vocal in the importance of volunteerism by allowing one's actions to speak louder than words. And Mrs. Deal's initiative, Read Across Georgia, is one that very much ties in with many of the organizations and values that Roswell Women's Club has supported over the last 65 years. So ladies and gentlemen, yes, we still have our gentlemen. It gives me great pleasure to present the First Lady of Georgia, Sandra Deal.
Nothing thrills my heart more than to get together with a group of ladies. It's nice to have some female company every once in a while. I think we enjoy our families, but it's nice when we have some time to spend with friends and to kind of renew our spirits. Of course, you know, my first love is these little ones. I just get the biggest thrill out of them, and you have to lose your total inhibitions when you're with them because you never know, and of course you notice that I did not know how to do all of the things they did. but it is fun.
Well, you know, when, of course, I've been the governor's wife for a long time, 47 years, but when he became the governor, they said, what are you going to have as your project? And I said, my project? I mean, I was trying to get him elected, not me. And I hadn't given 1 minute's thought to what I was going to do. And so, kind of out of desperation, I said, with a servant's heart, what feels right? You know, you need to know what feels right from the inside. And I've volunteered in the past in jobs that I found out I really didn't like so well. I was glad when they were over. I can remember one assignment I did. I volunteered for it because I loved the speech and hearing center. And my son had had speech lessons there. And I volunteered to work at the speech and hearing center. I thought that'd be a great place to be. Turned out the day I volunteered for was the day nobody came to the speech and hearing center. But it wasn't open. All I did was clean toilets and vacuum. And I was leaving crying babies at home to go do that. And I thought, this is not what I want to do. I don't feel like I'm really making a contribution. And I guess because I am a people person, that did not fit my lifestyle. I did it for a short time, and then I said, this is not my thing. I would like to be doing something else. And I think at times we find that what we're doing has become boring, or it doesn't fit our personality, and we don't feel like we're accomplishing what we really feel like we need to do. And so, that's why it's so wonderful that you have so many areas that you can volunteer in. I noticed the garden club, you mentioned the garden club, and I have friends who just garden all the time and just love doing the gardening. They get out and they're members of the Master Gardeners, and they have all these projects and do such wonderful things, teaching children how to grow their own food and how to harvest it, how to cut it up and cook it or eat it raw. And it's a thrill, and I love seeing that. And you have an opportunity to do some things like that, because a lot of our children don't know what comes from the garden. They don't know how their food is produced. And it is an important thing. Now, I like children. I liked teaching. But what I liked was sixth grade. And that's where I like to teach, because I could have a discussion with them and we could do projects. I thought that was great. But I had grown up in a family where my mother loved the toddlers. And of course, I was the oldest of four, so we had some toddlers. And I got to help with them. And so as a result of seeing her work with them, teaching them to march, get in line and march, and they'd pick out sticks and they'd hit their sticks together to do a rhythm. And she would sometimes take the oatmeal boxes and let them have drums, and they'd march to the drums. And just teaching them to play ball, just to throw the ball back and forth or to hit the ball. Things that we take for granted that children know. I mean, it just seems so natural. And then I realized as I became a teacher, a lot of parents don't know that. They didn't have mothers like mine who loved little ones, who played with them and taught them all these things. But I realized as I had to choose something to do as First Lady, that if we were going to make a difference in Georgia, in what happened with our economy, what happened with our state to keep us, our state strong, we needed to start in the beginning. We needed to work with our little ones. And even though I enjoyed the older ones, I felt like it was important to start with the little ones. And of course, I had had a little practice because I had read to quite a few children. And I was able to model after my mother and to read to them, get them involved and engaged and to ask them questions and to get them to think. And that's what we wanted. We want to help them to develop their minds and become creative. And I've also been about encouraging children to parents to see that their children know how to be put to bed properly, sleeping correctly in the crib alone, on their backs, and without a lot of encumbering covers and things. Getting the proper immunizations. I read just the other day that chickenpox is back being, I'm not chickenpox, whooping cough has reared its ugly head. And do I not remember? I do. I remember having the whooping cough. My cousin came to visit while his sister was being born and he had whooping cough and so did we. We got the whooping cough from him and we coughed and coughed and coughed. And so I remember how bad that was. Well, for infants, it's just almost deadly. It is very serious. And so immunizations are so important. I know that occasionally there is a problem with that, but the good outweighs the bad. And so I've encouraged immunizations and I encourage you to do that too, to encourage people to take their babies and get to the doctor and get those shots and things on the at the proper time and to keep a record so they don't have to do it twice. It is important for us to protect the rest of the children by having those immunizations, and that's why it's required at school. But we've also encouraged parents to start teaching their babies young. And I'm so glad we're doing this parent program here to have parents go in and have teachers go in and teach the parents to be the first teachers. We take it for granted that parents know how to do that. They don't. And so it's important for us to teach them how to read to their children, how to take simple objects and connect the colors, learn the colors, just with the tops of the detergent containers. I witnessed a teacher using those to teach the children because they come in all different colors according to the brand, and they're big enough they can't swallow it, so they can use those and they can sort and they can stack and they can identify the different colors, and that's important to do. And then to read to these children. But a lot of these parents don't have books. They move around a lot, and that's not something they think about buying. And so it's important to encourage them to read to their children, but it's important for them to model for their children, and we must always emphasize that too. Just like I learned from my mother, it's important children learn from their mothers and they learn from each other. And it's important for ladies to get together and share information, because we all learn a little bit more as we share information with each other. That's the benefit of having lady time, to get out together. You know, our men get together and do a lot of things, but it's important for women. We know that women have always done a lot of the background things, but it's also important for us to get out and do things that we get credit for. And to feel that worth, that self-worth. It is important to find the things that fit your talents, that appeal to you, where you really feel like when you leave and go home that day that it's impacted your life. And change. If you're doing something that is so boring, then find something else to do. If you're a people person, find something that involves the children, involves other people. If you're a person who doesn't like to deal with people, do the written work. Do the things that the filing, all of those things need to be done. Find your niche and do those things that appeal to you. And learn from each other. And whatever you do, wherever you do it, whether it's here in the preschool, in the garden club, in the community with historic preservation, I was, just as I left the mansion today, I went in to thank the ladies who had come to serve as docents there, and we can always use more docents. It just so happened some of them were from Roswell, and they were promoting visiting some of the homes here that you have on display. And I said, well, I've been to Bullock Hall. And I'm saying, well, you need to come to the others. And they were doing a little bit of promoting right there as they did some volunteer work at the mansion. But they're greeting lots of people from all over the world as they are volunteering at the mansion. We have international visitors and people from all over our nation. There are so many ways you can help. And of course, you can help with your money. And you have done that with your scholarships and with helping with supporting this preschool and supporting the teachers, because as was told to you earlier, the education of the teacher makes a lot of difference. I think, gosh, if I'd just known what I know now, I could have been such a better teacher. But you can't go back. All you can do is move forward and share that with others. And it may be that it's through helping support them in education by helping pay for their education or their training, or helping to provide good facilities for these little children, or encouraging young mothers in how they can help their children grow up and be successful, and to encourage people to read to their children and to volunteer to read if that's your niche, because they love to have people come in as guests and read to their children. Whatever you do, just do it with a servant's heart, and you will reap the benefits, and so will others, because they will feel how you feel as you engage with them. Thank you.
Thank you. And that so ties in with what we do as an organization and our volunteerism. If I could have last year's president, Carol Selmer, as well as last year's fundraising chair, Sherry Broadway, and the co-chairs, Danielle Thompson, Sharon Lowry, is Bonnie here? Okay, if you would come forward. And Donna, if you could join us.
Well, we all know we had a big challenge last year. We took a big risk, but I want everybody to give a big round of applause to Sherry and Sharon and Danielle. She gets to do the fun part.
Look at this big check. I'm so proud on behalf of the Roswell Women's Club and the Rock and Roswell fundraiser event to present this check to the Child Development Association, who's one of our partners in the community, and we're just so thrilled to help them support their goals, and sounds like they've got a lot of them. So really thank y'all so much for last year. This year coming up, we're gonna even do bigger numbers, hopefully, but we're pleased to give you this today.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Betty? Before Betty comes up and leads us in giving thanks, I would like to take a brief moment to direct you to the two candles that are on the table. The first candle is for our reflection of the loss of lives of all the children killed
in school violence these past years. The second candle is for us to reflect on the loss of lives this nation experienced 12 years ago on 9/11. May we pause for a moment of silence to honor all those we lost.
Heroes of United Flight 93, so in keeping with our reflection today of the horrific acts 12 years ago. On September 11, 2001, after terrorists attacked New York City and Washington, D.C., a group of passengers on United Flight 93 courageously fought to take control of their aircraft and their destiny by refusing to let their plane be used as another weapon. And these are some of the conversations that went on that flight. They're talking about crashing this plane into the ground. We have to do something. Thomas Burnett Jr. told his wife, Dina, on his cell phone, "I'm putting a plan together." "Who is helping you?" his wife said. "Different people, several people. There's a group of us. Don't worry, I'll call you back," he replied. Flight attendant Sandra Bradshaw called her husband and said she was boiling water as a weapon. Her final words, "Everyone's running to first class. I've got to go. Bye." "Let's roll," Todd Beamer said, famously added as they rushed to the front of the plane, likely using a beverage cart as a battering ram to break into the cockpit. Thanks to their bravery, their Boeing 757 crashed in a field in Shanksville, Pennsylvania, never reaching the terrorist's real target. It was approximately 20 minutes from Washington, D.C., where the plane would have struck either the White House or, more likely, the U.S. Capitol. Every passenger and all the terrorists lost their lives in the crash, but their bravery saved so many others. We will owe these men and women forever. If you'll bow your heads, we'll have a prayer before lunch. Dear God, we thank you for all the women here and all that they do. We thank you for the Child Development Center and all the children's lives that they touch. Thank you for the food we're about to partake, and be with us through this day. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen.
Ladies, I believe it is time to proceed to enjoy the food that the Hospitality Committee has helped organize. A brief hand for Rochelle and Wendy and their team. If I may suggest, if we have this table or this area start, and we'll just kind of follow so we don't all rush the table at one time. Enjoy. Please don't forget to have your picture taken, and we will come back for a brief meeting after lunch.
Oh, yeah, you're leaving, so. Okay.
Running